In this lesson, we'll discuss how to model bolts using beam elements in Ansys Mechanical and see how they can be connected with the rest of the assembly. We'll learn both the advantages and the disadvantages of each method and do a comparative study between modeling a simple system using solid and beam elements. Earlier, we discussed why modeling bolts using solid elements can be expensive to solve. Therefore, simplified methods such as modeling bolts using beam elements is desirable as long as they provide accurate results for the objective of the analysis. This method is most suitable while modeling the effect of the preload to study its impact on the performance of the entire assembly. Details of the stresses in and around the bolt would be available too. However, if one's objective demands detail and accuracy in these stresses, then this method may not be the appropriate choice. Instead, modeling bolt using solid elements is preferred. In this lesson, we'll focus on applications where bolts can be modeled using beam elements. If we decide to use beam elements for modeling bolts, then there are few pre-processing steps that we need to follow. In general, the CAD geometry of the assembly includes bolt head, nuts, and washers that need not be used when we represent bolts as line bodies. So, we can delete them from the geometry, but before we do that, it's strongly recommended to imprint the faces of the bolt head or nut or the washer on the mating parts. This is because we need to connect the vertex of the line body representing the bolt to the mating parts, and it's more accurate to do so on a surface instead of an edge, so the forces are distributed over a finite area as opposed to distributing it over an edge. The imprints can be created in SpaceClaim using tools such as imprints, which can be found under Prepare tab, and the Project tool, which can be found under Design tab. The imprints tool automatically detects all the surfaces that are in contact in the visible parts and creates their imprints. If there are any parts that are not in contact, one can use the Project tool to manually project curves from bolt heads or nuts or washers to the mating parts to create imprints. This method is not automated, but it can be used when imprints tool fails due to gaps or geometric artifacts or any other limitations that we may encounter. In case of modeling bolts using beam elements, we have two additional options. One is to model bolts using beam connections, and the other is by modeling bolts as line bodies. It's recommended to use beam connections since there is no need for the bolt geometry and the mesh is created automatically with beam elements by Ansys Mechanical. The advantages of using beam connections include minimal effort in pre-processing, automation of creating beams using object generator, and simple drag and drop operations to create pretension objects. These advantages make using beam connections the recommended way of modeling bolts using beam elements. Let's go into more details about beam connections and see how they are connected to the rest of the assembly. A beam connection has two ends that are to be connected to the mating surfaces. They can use an edge-to-edge or a face-to-face connection, where one from each component is selected as mobile and the reference side respectively. But how do we connect a vertex or a point to an edge or an area? Beam connections use remote points to connect with the edges or faces selected as reference and mobile. Remote points are pilot nodes that are connected to the mesh nodes on the scoped edges or surfaces using constraint equations. These constraint equations mimic a bonded connection between the remote point and the mesh nodes. Each remote point has 6 degrees of freedom, 3 in translations and 3 in rotations. And together, they provide complete description of what occurs with the pilot node in space. The nodes on the scope geometry, in general, belong to solid elements, and they have only 3 degrees of freedom, which are in translation. This is because the rotation of the solid body about one of its points can be described as translation of other points in space. So, solid elements don't need rotational degrees of freedom. On the other hand, a vertex at the end of a beam is just a point. So, without the rotational degree of freedom, we don't know if the point is rotating in space. Coming back to connecting vertex to face or edge. The pilot node is connected to the solid geometry by multi-point constraint equations, also known as MPC equations. The solver uses MPC equations to make the connections between remote points and scope geometry. MPC equations are mathematical equations which relate various degrees of freedom to each other, and they are solved for during solution process. But how do the MPC equations work? Let's take a generic case of a system of equations with 3 unknowns A, B, and C. Say we solve for the unknowns by imposing an additional constraint A equals to B plus C that must be satisfied. In this case, we can't solve for A directly from the original set of equations because of the constraint A equals to B plus C. In order to solve using the original equations along with the constraint, we must convert A into a dependent variable by substituting it with B plus C in the original equations. We can then solve for B and C since they are the remaining independent variables. Once we get their value, we can calculate A using the constraint equation A equals to B plus C. This simple example explains the MPC concept. The important thing to remember is that by including MPCs in a model, we're converting all the degrees of freedom into either dependent or independent degrees of freedom. While solving for them in such a system, first, the dependent degrees of freedom are removed from the system of equations and solve only for independent degrees of freedom. We then calculate the dependent degrees of freedom by processing the MPCs. This is how the MPC equations are solved for. Earlier, we mentioned that constraint equations mimic a connection between the remote point and the nodes on the scoped edge or surface. But how do these nodes move with respect to the remote point? To control this, remote point allows us to define the behavior of the scope geometry. In this case, it represents the behavior of the face representing the bolt head or nut as either rigid or deformable. Rigid behavior can be imagined by having infinitely stiff material connecting the remote point pilot node to the scope geometry of the remote point. Because of this, the nodes on the scope geometry will not deform. Mathematically, this means that the remote point pilot node has the independent degree of freedom, while the nodes of the scope geometry have dependent degrees of freedom. So, the nodes of the scope geometry must follow the motion of the pilot node. Deformable behavior may be thought of as an opposite extreme. In this case, the pilot node must follow the motion of the nodes of the scope geometry. So, the region between the pilot node and the scope geometry is not infinitely stiff. Instead, we are essentially limiting the motion of the pilot node to be average movement of the nodes of the scope geometry. In this case, the pilot node has the dependent degrees of freedom, while the nodes of the scope geometry have independent degrees of freedom. So, which one do we pick in our analysis? Deformable behavior, in general, would provide more accurate results. However, since we don't expect much relative deformation occurring under the bolt head, a rigid behavior can be fine too, especially because rigid option uses fewer independent degrees of freedom and therefore is less computationally expensive. Note that the remote point behavior describes the behavior of the scope geometry. It doesn't describe what happens with the bolt shank or the mating parts. So, don't worry that the rigid behavior will make the entire bolted joint to be rigid. While beam connections are very easy to work with, they do have some limitations, such as beam connections don't update if geometric changes are made, and they need to be created again using object generator if design iterations are made. Also, the bold tool, which is used to review multiple bold results at once, does not support using beam connections. Finally, if an application involves large rotation, in which case pretension object can no longer be used, beam connections cannot be used as they don't have a geometry associated with them. In such cases, the alternative method to modeling bolts using beam elements is to use the line body. In the CAD file, if the bolts are available as solid bodies, after the imprints for bolt heads, nuts and washers are made, we can use the slice body option to slice the bolt joint. Once we have a cylindrical body with uniform cross section, we can use profile tool in SpaceClaim to extract the line body and the corresponding cross section. Next, we can move on to Ansys Mechanical to connect the line vertex to the mating surfaces with a vertex to edge or face type connection. There are two ways of achieving this. One is by using a fixed joint, which uses a series of MPC equations, and the other is a bonded contact using MPC formulation, which also uses MPC equations. If both the methods use MPC equations, then how are they different from each other? In case of an MPC bonded contact, the forces are transferred between the contact side and the target side. The vertex of the bolt is selected as the contact side, and the edge of the hole or the surface of the imprint representing the bolt head or the washer is selected as target. The default contact formulation is not MPC. So, change the formulation to MPC, the connection type to distributed anywhere inside the pinball radius, and set the pinball radius to equal to or slightly larger than the diameter of the hole or the imprint, if there is one. The same definition must be made on both ends of the bolt. In this method, the forces are distributed to only those nodes on the mating part that fall within the pinball radius. So, the accuracy of force distribution is dependent on the mesh around the holes. One way of reducing this dependency is by using a fixed joint. In case of a fixed joint, the vertex of the bolt is selected as the mobile and the edge of the hole or the imprint surface is selected as the reference. In this case, the nodes on the mating part are connected to a remote point, which in turn is connected to the nodes on the mating surface. The dependency on mesh still exists, but it's not as prominent as in the case of MPC bonded contact. The only drawback of using a fixed joint is that it uses a specific type of numerical solver, which can be computationally expensive, especially in case of large models that consume a lot of physical memory. As you can see, representing bolt as a line body involves many pre-processing steps as opposed to using beam connections, and therefore increases the pre-processing effort. Now, let's look at the case study in which we solve a model of a bolted flange that has a seal sandwiched due to bolt preload. The bolts are modeled using two methods, one using the solid elements and the other uses beam elements. In this case study, we are comparing different quantities of interest, such as contact pressure at the inner surface of the seal and on the full surface of the seal, the stresses in the flange and the seal. The main function of the seal is to prevent the leakage of gas or liquid. The leakage occurs when the contact pressure on the seal falls below its minimum seal pressure. In the first case, we are modeling bolt using a solid body, and in the second case, the bolt is modeled using beam connection. Note that when we use the beam connection, the representation of the bolt is just a cylinder with no bolt head or nut. Therefore, the stiffness of the bolted joint is slightly different between these two cases. Here are the results for contact pressure measured at the inner surface of the seal for both the cases. We notice a difference of 3.3% in the results, which shows that the contact pressure is reasonably accurate using both the methods. We observe a similar behavior with contact pressure over the full seal surface, which further ascertains our earlier observation. So, if the objective of our study is to assess the performance of the seal, then using beam connections to represent the bolt is the recommended way. Now, let's look at the stresses in the mating parts and the seal from both the cases. Starting with the full assembly, here are the equivalent stresses reported by both the models. We see that using beam connections underpredicts the average stresses in the assembly by almost 20% compared to the solid elements. And here are the differences in stresses in seal from both the methods. The difference is not as prominent as in the whole assembly. This shows that the level of accuracy is affected in the parts in closer proximity to the bolts and not the full assembly. So, if the user is interested in studying the stresses in the bolt or the parts which they are connected to, then using solid elements is the recommended method.